tasted and seen of the sweetest of love. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope.
Of the sweetest of love.
When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone,
your presence, Lord. Oh,
Holy Spirit,
you are experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware.
Your presence, Lord.
Good morning, Metropolitan. Welcome to our virtual online worship experience for this Pentecost Sunday 2020. Pentecost is an interesting concept because it really is the celebration of the empowerment of the church. Many people call it the birthday of the church. Whatever you call it, this is the day that the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it as we celebrate together. Let's sing our morning hymn, that wonderful hymn of the church. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. And after that singing, Sister Nancy Greaves will lead us in our affirmation of faith.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now reverently and sincerely declare the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body.
Thank you, Sister Nancy. Beloved, anthems are a great part of our service. You hear me say that every Sunday because it is so true. This morning we have selected as our anthem a wonderful rendition by Carter of that wonderful hymn, "O for a Faith That Will Not Shrink." It is rendered today by the Aeolians of the Oakwood University in Huntsville, Alabama. These young people sing like they know about that faith. After the singing, Brother Martin Jackson will read our scripture lesson for the morning.
Grief. Good morning, Metropolitan. I'll be reading the scripture this morning coming from 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 32, and then verses 37 to 41. David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart fail because of the Philistines, for your servant will go out and fight with him." Verse 37. And David said, "The Lord who delivered me out of the paw of the lion, out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of the Philistines." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." And Saul clothed David with his armor, and he put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a cloak of mail. And then David girded his sword over his armor, and when he tried to go, he could not, for he was not used to it. And David said to Saul, "I cannot go with thee, for I am used to them." And David took them off. For he took off his staff in his head and chose 5 smooth stones of the brook and put them in his shepherd bag and in his pouch and his sling in his hand. And he drew near the Philistines. And the Philistines came on and drew near David and the man who bore the shield going before him. Thus have the reading of the said of the word. May it bless your heart through this pandemic. Amen.
My brothers, my sisters, prayer is always in order and the order of the day. Today on this Pentecost Sunday, we have selected to focus on the Spirit of God, that inurement, that empowerment for the church. And so our prayer centering moment is that wonderful little ditty that we sing from time to time, "Sweet, Sweet Spirit." It is rendered today, and as we share in this centering moment, we prepare ourselves to talk with the Lord. The Reverend Norman Jones will lead us in prayer after we sing. Let's worship and let's pray.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And I know that the Spirit of the Lord. Same thing. There are sweet expressions. There are sweet expressions. Expressions on each face.
Let us pray. Jesus, we thank you. God, we thank you. Holy Spirit, we thank you. Holy Spirit, today is the day that we celebrate you. We thank you for the gift that Jesus left us, which is the power of the Holy Spirit, that you were able to come and touch each and every one of our lives. Lord, sometimes we wasted such a precious gift, from such an awesome God who wants to see us succeed. Help us, Lord, as we continue on this journey to serve such an awesome God. Help us, Lord, to examine our lives as we move forward through this pandemic. Lord, if we don't question our relationship with you, if we don't question whether or not we're doing the right thing, then we're lacking something. So Lord, pour into us what we're missing to serve the kingdom. Lord, the kingdom needs you. There's pandemics and our people are dying at disproportionate numbers. Lord, we don't understand. Lord, we ask that you come and show us something's terribly, terribly wrong. We know that the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, but Lord, right now we're a little bit confused. There's so much hate going on. People are being killed in cold blood without any remorse. Lord, we recognize that this is spiritual warfare, and we cannot win this battle without you. We need the Holy Spirit to come into our lives, to come into our hearts, and to come into our minds. Usually, Lord, we gather and we feel the presence, but right now, Lord, you have sheltered us in to seek you. If every one of us would seek the Holy Spirit on Sunday, what an awesome, powerful move of God it would be. He asks that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will heal them. Lord, right now we have a chance to be obedient. At Sunday that we can just hunker down and spend some time and seek your presence and seek your direction and seek your word and hear your voice and do what thus saith the Lord. Lord, we need you. We thank you, Lord. You have pushed your pastors and your leaders to the ultimate. But Lord, they can do it. They're holding it together. They're Zooming and conferencing and calling and getting the work done. And maybe, Lord, this is what you meant. Because now you said your word would be preached to every nation, that every nation would know your name. Whether they believe it or not, they know who you are. Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, crucified for our sins. Yes, Lord, help us to accept that. We don't want to think about what we did not wrong. We think about it, but we're not going to dwell on it. Because you give us new graces and new mercies every morning, because you know every morning we are out there fighting a new devil, and we cannot fight that new devil with old mercies and graces. So Lord, we know that you are our sovereign God. We know that we have work to do. We want to be on the right side. We're listening, we're praying, we're needing you like never before. Touch the bereaved, touch the sick, touch the ones that are in question. Lord, there's just so much. Be by every bedside whose person is in the hospital by themselves. Be with the family who's worrying about them. Being with those who have had to let their people go without them knowing that they love them. Help us, Lord. Help us to be of service to those, to love on those who have lost their loved ones. Give us the grace that surpasses all understanding. Help us to be kind. Help us to be true. Help us to love you. Help us to know that the government here on earth is not who we listen to, but you are our sovereign government. You are our president. You are our CEO. You tell us what to do. You tell us how to live, and that's what we will do. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Beloved, as we prepare for the Word of God today, our ministry of music will bless us, and after which, the Word of God. This sermon today was a sermon that was preached by this pastor a few years ago as I shared with the Green Memorial Church in Portland, Maine, for their men's weekend. It was a word in season then, and I trust it'll bless you today. It's entitled, The Church is in a Battle, and Here is How We Win. Be blessed by the singing, and be blessed by the word.
One time, John, come on. The Spirit.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is,
there's liberty.
There is liberty.
Of the Spirit.
Where the Spirit
of the Lord,
of the Lord is, the captives are set free. The wounded are made whole.
There's rest.
I'll find rest for my
soul. Come on, family, where the Spirit is at.
Where the Spirit.
Yeah.
Oh, 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 oh.
Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit is.
There is.
There is liberty.
Yeah. One more time in Jesus' name, everyone. Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit.
The Lord is.
Of the Lord is.
There's liberty.
There is liberty.
Yeah. Where the Spirit,
where the Spirit
of the Lord is,
of the Lord is, the captives are set free,
the wounded are made whole,
the wounded are made whole,
there's rest for your soul,
there is rest.
Here we go.
For your soul,
where the Spirit is,
where the Spirit is,
yeah, yeah. Come on, where the Spirit is, say it.
Where the Spirit.
Come on, say it one more time in Jesus' name. Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit is.
Hallelujah. Come on, come on. Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit is.
Yeah. There is healing. Tell them, family, say it.
There is healing.
Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit is.
Yeah, yeah. There's deliverance. Say it.
There's deliverance.
Where the Spirit is, come on.
Where the Spirit is.
Yeah, come on, tell them. There's joy. Say it.
There's joy.
Where the Spirit is.
Where the Spirit is.
Come on, somebody. Have a little touch with them. Say it again. There's joy.
Say it.
There's joy. There's joy.
Hallelujah. Come on, say it.
Where the Spirit is.
Come on, Stephanie. Say it one time, Stephanie. Where the Spirit is,
where the Spirit is,
there's liberty.
Pastor read from 1 Samuel 17 and 39. And while this is, again, was supposed to be for the men, it's fitting for the sisters too. All right. Amen?
Amen?
It's for the sisters too. Chapter 17, and I want to zoom in just for a moment. To that 39th verse. That 39th verse. In fact, 38 and 39 captures the essence of what I want to share this morning. Here's what it says. Then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. Saul dressed David in Saul's tunic. He put a coat of armor on him
and a bronze helmet on his head, and David fashioned on his sword over the tunic and tried walking around because he was not used to them.
All right. Come on, Lord.
I cannot go in these, he said to Saul. David says to Saul, I cannot go in these because I am not used to them. So he took them off. And he took in his staff, his hand, he took in his staff in his hand, chose five smooth stones from the stream and put them in his pouch. And with his sling in his hand, he approached the challenge.
All right.
I'll talk this morning from the subject, Christians. We are in a battle, and here's how we win. We are in a battle, and here is how we win. Now, I need some help with this sermon this morning. I need some help. I need to know how many of you sitting on the sound of my weak voice have ever been in a battle.
Well,
now, I didn't ask you if you served in the Army, maybe the Air Force, the Marine. Have you ever been in a battle?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, that battle may have been for a personal challenge. That battle may have been for your faith. That battle may have been to keep your faith in God. That battle may have been just to overcome some adversity. That battle may have been just to live in the same household with him or her. But whatever it is, have you ever? You're just out of one.
Right.
Fasten your seatbelt. You're on the way into one. And the church is murdering. You ever sit out of VIP or respond quickly in the midst of your battle, a pity party right in the midst of it, and inviting other folk to come?
Jesus. Yes, sir.
And then wondering to yourself why nobody shows up. Life is full of battles. We struggle day by day, and especially when you make the decision that you're going to be a child of God. It always amazes me because folks say, you know, I decided to follow Jesus and the devil hadn't left me alone yet. Well, do you think the devil is crazy? Do you think the devil is just going to let you to go to heaven unfettered, unbothered, not antagonized? The devil seeketh whom he may devour. He comes but for to steal, kill, and destroy. And this battle, y'all, is not always what it's cut up to be.
Well, right.
Sometimes we're fighting against ourselves.
That's right.
You ever been in a fight with yourself? I know you say, this man crazy. Where did Pastor get him from? I've got better sense than to be fighting with myself. But the truth of the matter, y'all, is some of us fight with ourselves.
That's right.
We tell ourselves, I ain't gonna do it. I ain't gonna say it. I ain't gonna act like that. I ain't gonna do it. And before we get the words out of our mouth, we find ourselves doing exactly what we said. We find ourselves acting exactly like we said we would not. responding in ways that surprise even us. Man, these battles are challenged. And guess what? They are not limited to male nor female. They're not limited to white nor black. They're not limited to young nor old. They're not limited to been here a long time or just got here yesterday. These battles keep coming. And we agreed on yesterday that we want to win. Yes, any winners in the house?
All right.
I mean, anybody in here that just want to win?
No.
Hey, don't be ashamed of it. Listen, nobody gets in the fight to lose.
That's right. That's right.
Don't jump in the fight and say, come on, man, beat me down. I'm ready. You get in the fight to win. Amen.
Amen.
We get in the fight to overcome. We get in the fight to make our witness known. We get in the fight so even if we get beat up, at least somebody knows we were in the fight. It's easy to sit on the side. When I was a kid, I had two older brothers, and they were terrible. They really were terrible. They didn't go to Sunday school. They didn't go to church. Mama would try to make us go, and they were just hard-headed. Would go. I was always there. I was a good boy. I'm glad they're not here, because I probably wouldn't get an amen right here. Used to always take advantage, Ken, of their toughness. I was a feist dog. I would yap. Because I knew my brothers, who were terrible, had my back. So I knew I could win. I could call in the heavy artillery. Until one day I was talking and flapping my lips. I was wolfing big time. Because I knew my brothers were with me. But unbeknownst to me, a young lady had crossed their attention.
Distraction.
And I'm sitting steady talking, thinking no problem, I call in the heavy artillery. And when I looked around, they were gone. They were over there talking, and I'm facing the challenge of my life. There's several ways to win. Get on in it, or you can run. I got in it. I got beat down. But I left some licks. At least the fellas who beat me down, they knew they'd been in a fight. Now they won, but at least they knew. What I'm challenging us this morning, men, women, brothers, sisters, is to remember we are in a battle for our lives. The enemy doesn't want us to win, but we can if we've got the secret to win.
Yes, sir.
God has designed every one of us to be winners.
Yes, sir.
If not, then you ought to wake up in the morning, whether you get up early like me or late like Ken. You ought to look in that mirror and say, mirror. No, don't say mirror. Call your name. And you ought to say, you are a winner. Can I get a witness? Yes, I know some of us struggle with challenges, but we ought to look at ourselves in the mirror and say, you are a winner. You ought to look at yourself in the mirror and say, you are a winner. Then if that measure of doubt hits your mind, you ought to back it up with some faith, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You ought to say, I'm a winner, because if God be for me, who can be against me? And so in order this morning to help us to know that we got it, God guided my attention to this Old Testament text in 1 Samuel. You remember young David. Brothers, we talked about him yesterday. Young David was the runt of the litter.
Yes, sir.
He was the little fella. He was the one not expected to be much to him, but yet he rose beyond that of his older siblings. He was the man.
Amen.
And one day David is called into a confrontation with his Goliath. Can I suggest to us this morning that all of us face Goliaths? Amen. You got a Goliath. Everybody faces at one time or another your Goliath. David comes on the scene and notices the mighty men, watch this, the mighty men who were warriors having a quandary about who would go to battle.
Well, my mind.
See, everybody talk ain't talk. Everybody that shoots it off of the mouth can't really hold or back up what it is that they're saying. And so there they are discussing among themselves who's going to go to battle. And can't you just hear them? Well, I do it, but I really don't have time. I'll get it next time. Can't you hear them say, well, I'm not about all of that. I'm going to just pray about it and hopefully let the Lord fight my battle. No. Here they are discussing who's going to go to battle. And everybody in the group said, oh, no, not me. There he is, Lord. Send him. I know we ain't got no folk like that up here at Green Memorial. We answer like Isaiah, hear my Lord. Send me. But there were some folk in that crowd say, hey, Lord, I really would go if I had time, but I don't have time right now. So if you just let them handle it, I'll be the backup. No. God put you in the battle to win. And every now and then, you got to be in the, watch this, you got to be in the fight to win it.
That's right.
You don't go looking for it. But by golly, you don't have to run from it either. Because there is a God who rules above with hands of power and heart of love. And if I'm right, he'll fight your battle and you'll have peace someday. And so here comes David. David says, I got this. And so David takes on his giant. But I mean, can I suggest to you, life would be so much better sometime if we would take on our giant? Listen, what you scared of?
Well,
I used to say, well, Reverend, you didn't talk all that faith talk you want to. You don't know what I've been through. Well, did you make it through it? Reverend, you don't know what I faced in my life. You don't know where the Lord has brought me from. Well, aren't you broke from it? See, the challenge of life is to get on the other side of through and look back where God has brought you from. That provides for you a witness and a testimony that if God could do it before, he can do it again. And so David goes to battle, but Saul wanting to help. And here's where I'm going today. Saul says, wait a minute, you can't go to battle like that. And so Saul takes his armor. Y'all remember?
Yes, sir.
He puts it on little David. The whole thing.
The whole thing.
And then sends David out, you ready now. You have to be careful letting folk put. You gotta be careful with folk telling you what you need in order to become what God wants you to be. You can't take everybody's prescription.
Oh, come on now. Yes, sir.
Can I preach this? You can't operate with everybody's thought. If God leads you into battle, God is big enough to bring you through it. David puts on Saul's armor, and you all remember the story. He starts to try to move. And David discovered, this stuff is too much for me. I can't wear this. If I go to battle with this, he gonna beat me down. Hello, somebody? Can I get a witness? Let me suggest something to you. Sometimes if we take a hold of what folk put on us to win the battle of life, the devil gonna cover you over your head. Pull that crap off and operate in the power and in the spirit of God. For if God sets you free, you're free indeed. So the text says that David says, I can't wear this. And he took it off, and he went to battle. The end of the story, and I'm about done, is David won. Can I tell you the end of your story even before we finish?
Well,
if you stick with God, you the man. You the woman. You a winner. You don't have to wait till the battle's over. You can shout right now. You don't have to wait till the epilogue. You already know that he who has begun a good work in you will perform that work until the day of Jesus. You are a winner. Well, Pastor, how can I win? Well, I got three things and I'm done. First of all, you got to work with your own stuff.
Yes, sir.
Wouldn't it be nice if you could play like this brother? I mean, I'm a musician by training, and I was watching him. He was just doing it. I was thinking to myself, I wonder if these old fingers could move like that. Lewis, he's my brother. He's talking about he bet they could. They probably can't do. Not like they used to then.
Back in the day.
The brothers on the instruments, the singers, even with their head wrapped. I mean, the singers. The brothers who came up who didn't come to choir rehearsal and didn't practice. Yeah. Huh? The sisters who just join in to help make us look good. Everybody in here has a gift from God.
Yes, sir.
And guess what? That's your stuff.
That's right.
It doesn't have to be like anybody else. It doesn't have to function like anybody else. God especially gifted you with a gift. Just suppose you use your stuff. Well, you know, if I were you, I was so and so and so. Yeah, but you're not me.
Amen.
Can I get a witness? You know, in my opinion, if I were you, I would, yes, but your opinion is nice, it works for you, but in my opinion, I've got to follow God, because if God leads me wherever I'm going, I'm a winner, because I'm following God. You got to use your own stuff. If it doesn't work, take it off. Be nice about it, but take it off.
Yeah.
I mean, don't be mean. Be nice. Thank you just the same. But take it off. But then not only must you operate with your own stuff, watch this. You gotta function in your own style.
Yes, sir.
Amen. There's nothing worse than trying to do something and you not being the authentic you. You being a makeshift of somebody else. Can I preach this? Well, I'm going on back to Hartford in a minute. Don't be too upset. You got to operate in your own style. Because God can use the authentic you better than he can a fake makeshift you. And listen, God knows what he made when he made you. He knows the flaws and all. It always amazes me how some folks try to cover up their flaws.
Come on now.
When God already knows. It ain't anybody else's business but God. But God knows. He called you like you. He made you as you.
Yes, sir.
And God can use you as you.
Yes, sir.
I hear David saying, listen. The armor might be good for you, but the armor that I want to use is I've been in a tussling match with a bear and I won. That armor might work for you, but I've been in the very perimeter of the paws of a lion and I won. It may work for you, but I've been right on the precipice of defeat, and God himself came to my rescue. It ain't my style to walk around in heavy armor. But give me 5 smooth stones.
Yes, sir.
And I'll take him out.
Yes, sir.
See, let me tell you something. If you got God with you, you don't need a whole heap more. If you got God with you, you don't need a whole lot more. If you got God with you, God is more than the enemy can ever be against you. So you got to use your own stuff. You got to operate in your style. And I promise you, you got to tell your story. There's somebody out there just waiting to hear your story. There's somebody out there just waiting to hear what the Lord has done for you. Where he's brought you from, what he's brought you through. And beloved, your story is designed to bless the life of somebody else. Isn't it crazy just to rehearse our story to ourselves? I mean, just sit around and be talking to yourself about your story. Man, yeah. You know, Lord been good to me. Yes, he has. I don't know how you would have made it. Yes, you're right. I mean, you're just having a full-blown conversation with you. You think that's going to help you much? But so, just suppose you find somebody that's going through the very midst of what you've been through. And say, listen, come, let me tell you something. I once was, but now, look where he's brought me from.
Yes, sir.
I declare that story may bless their lives beyond measure. And beloved, The winning of the battle is based on us being willing to tell our story.
Yes, sir.
Patty Crosby was blind and couldn't see. But she told her story.
That's right.
Can I get a witness?
Yes,
she said, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I'm an heir of salvation. I've been purchased by God. I'm born of his spirit. I'm washed in his blood. And Fanny says, this is my story. This is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Is there anybody in here that's got a story? Some brother, some sister, some son, some daughter, my friend, my newfound friend. Do you have a story this morning? I challenge you to tell it. Tell it wherever you go. And as you tell it, work with your stuff, operate in your style, and tell your story. Amen.
That word reminds us of our individuality when it comes to God. While we corporate, we are still individuals that God can use for his glory. Maybe as you listen to the word today, you won't be like little David. You want to make sure you use your own stuff, that you operate in your style. And as it's all over and when your witness has been made known, that you tell your story. You know, everybody has a story. Your story is not mine, my story is not yours, but we all have one. And when we begin to function in that zone, people are blessed, the church is edified, and the church is revived. And so today, maybe you want to be a part of this movement, the ecclesia, the called out ones. Maybe you want to make a change in your life for the better. Pandemic has taught you that we may have to be in this world by ourselves, but we really don't, because God always is with us. And so if that decision is yours today to walk with Jesus, to make a step in that direction, I hope you'll pray the prayer, Lord, save me. I'm a sinner. Take me as your own. And I declare unto you, he'll do it, and he'll do it just now. And so if that's your step today, that's your journey, I hope you'll give us a call at the church office, 860-527-7087. And one of our ministers will be in touch with you so that we can help you along in this new walk with the Lord. Shall we pray today? I want to pray for you. I want to pray for all of us that the Lord will indeed empower us. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this Pentecost Sunday. This Sunday when we celebrate the empowerment of your people called the church. We ask you, O God, to enable us and empower us that we might be your witnesses, yes, even in this dark world. Bless us that we might be a blessing to others. Give to us what we need, that in your giving to us, we might realize that you only give to us that we might indeed give to others, that they may see good works and glorify not us, but glorify you which art in heaven. Grant us wisdom and grant us courage as we continue to face these hours and we live out these days. In Jesus' name, amen. Beloved, it's time now for all of us to share in this worship experience in our own way. Now, you've got a clue on how you need to do it, because God has already said to us, bring ye all the tithe and offering into the storehouse, that there might be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith. See that I'll open up the windows of heaven, pour you out blessings that there shall not be room enough to receive. We're excited here at Metropolitan because while the building is shut down, our faith has not, neither has our giving. And so there are several ways you can share in the giving. You know what they are. You can put your gift in the mail. You can drop it off by the office. You can use one of our online portals, Give Plus or Cash App. Or you can call the office and one of our officers will be more than delighted to come by and pick your offering up for you. Whatever your choice, please do it. The church needs you and your faith is embodied by what we do. And so I hope you give. I'm going to write my check now. And while we're giving, the music ministry will be a blessing to us. It'll help you give. God bless you.
Thank you.
started on Wednesday past the Hartford District Metropolitan Church, we had a wonderful opportunity to hear from our Episcopal leadership, Bishop and Mrs. Proctor, who came on our call, shared with us inspirational words, and they were a blessing to the district. This morning, they have chosen to come back and to virtually visit the Metropolitan Church. If we were in person, I'd ask you to stand and receive the bishop, but I trust you standing wherever you are. But if not, would you receive Bishop and Mrs. Proctor as they greet us on this wonderful Sunday service? God bless. Let's hear our bishop.
Good morning. Happy Pentecost Sunday to you. What a joy it is for me to greet you and to have the supervisor with me. Matter of fact, why don't you greet us real quick?
Greetings, Northeastern Episcopal District. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I am truly rejoicing and thanking Him for being connected to you yet again, albeit modern technology. I encourage you to use this avenue also to stay connected to each other, to continue to pray without ceasing, and to believe and trust God to see us through. God bless you and happy Pentecost Sunday.
Indeed, it is a happy Pentecost Sunday. Can you believe that this is the first time in 41 years that my wife and I have spent this much time together without other people, without children, without churches? It has been an enjoyable and different experience. God maketh us to lie down to give us messages, and how we appreciate that. Our prayers are also with the members of the Northeastern Episcopal District. We've had more death, more sickness, more confinement than any other Episcopal area in our connection, and indeed throughout the land. Our prayers are with you. They're with you because all of us need to have the ministering power of God, who said that He is the great God of all comfort, and He will bring to us the solace that only He can. Remember this, that ultimate healing is when God takes us from these bodies of flesh and blood and gives us a glorified body. That's ultimate healing. No more sickness, no more pain, no high blood, no diabetes, no COVID-19, nothing that will be able to separate us from the presence and the joy of Almighty God. We're people who believe that our churches are going to open as soon as it's safe for us to come in. We believe in the blood of Jesus. Yes, we plead it and we believe in it, but we also believe in Purell. We believe in being washed in the blood of the Lamb, but we also want to wash our hands. And it is important now on this day of Pentecost. Acts 1 said they were in one place on one accord. And as they move into Acts 2, when the Spirit comes in, it tells us that it's possible to be in one place and not be on one accord. That means that we're an aggregation and not a congregation. But today we are congregation because we're on one accord and we're thanking God for each other. Please be safe. Please check on one another, if it's only to find out how you're doing, how you're feeling. But we are indeed family. And so it's good to just know that you're there. We're okay over here. We are sheltering in place like they did in the early church. And we're just praying that we will know when God wants us to come back into the physical building. I know we're going to be dancing up a storm coming down the aisle because we've been away for so long. Thank God for you. Thank you for remembering my birthdays. Thank you for just the small things that we do, the funny cards, the funny statements, whatever was sent. It means a great deal to us to know that we're connected and you see my sometimes sarcastic sense of humor that you all can relate to, and I appreciate you. Well, I think that's long enough on your video service. We thank God for you. Goodbye. See you soon.
Thank you so much, Bishop and Mrs. Proctor, for coming and sharing with us here in our virtual worship experience. At Metropolitan, isn't it wonderful to have a team of Episcopal leadership that have embraced this present reality, not new normal, present reality as we go through this COVID-19 season. He blessed us. They blessed us the other night. And indeed, it's a blessing to have them with us today. Thank you again so much, my bishop, our supervisor. Now, we're preparing to close our service today, but I won't do that without reminding you of our announcements, which will be scrolling at the end of the service. Please, my brothers and my sisters, take note of those things that will affect us in the days and weeks ahead. Please be reminded, if you have not yet, to complete the census. The census is so important for our community because many of our impoverished and challenged communities who do not fill out the census don't realize that those numbers make a difference when it comes to the dollars that will come down for these improvements. So I hope you do it. It's very, very important. And then secondly, let me remind those of you, if you have not been tested, your COVID-19 testing, it is so important that we do that. It won't save lives, but I declare it will really help us to put a curve, flatten the curve on this COVID-19. The tests are free now. You don't need a prescription. You don't need a doctor's reference. You don't need insurance. All you need is to call, make an appointment, and go and be tested. I'm challenging every member of Metropolitan, young and old, if you have not done it, please do so today. Your life and our lives count on it. I know you'll do it. You're that kind of people. Thank you today for joining us on this worship service, and it's time for us to go. But we'll leave this virtual presence, but we'll never leave the presence of God. Would you bow your heads with me as we shall be dismissed? And now may grace, peace, truth, and love from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost rest, rule, and abide with all of us now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you.